Welcome to the Heartland United Methodist Church Sanctuary. I'm glad you're here online to worship with us today. Just some quick announcements. We'll be receiving communion near the end of today's service, so if you would like to participate, make sure you have whatever bread and juice you have available for that time in the service. The worship team this week is carefully and sanitarily putting together some Lenten kits for our online use as we move through the Lenten season. The items will give us focal points we can use at home that will tie into the themes as we broadcast our services. Later next week, you can pick one up at the church, or if you want to make sure you get one per participant, we can deliver or mail them to you as well, if you let the office know. This week, we'll have fellowship time at noon, and the worship team is scheduled for Wednesday at 12:30. I want to thank our participants today for this recording. Charles Kirkpatrick is running the technical aspects. Donna and Kathy are working with the music, and they're also our readers for the day. Let's pray. Holy God, creator of the world and everything in it, we come before you this morning to praise and glorify you. We rejoice in the wonders of your creation and all the ways you faithfully provide for us and sustain us each day. Open our hearts and minds to your word and fill us with your spirit as we worship you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing along with the song, Forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. He is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and outstretched arm, his love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong, forever God is with us. Forever, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever. God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever.
Because God is faithful, Paul rhetorically asks. The answers are supposed to be an obvious yes.
Does your life in Christ give you strength? Does his love comfort you? Do we share together in the Spirit? Do you have mercy and kindness?
Then live in harmony by showing love for each other, having one mind and purpose. In whatever you do, don't let selfishness or pride be your guide. Be humble and honor others more than yourselves.
Don't be interested only in your own life, but care about the lives of others too. Think and act like Christ Jesus. He was truly God, but he did not think that his being equal to God was something to use for his own benefit.
He gave up his place with God and made himself nothing. He became like one of us. And while living as a man, he humbled himself and was fully obedient to God. He obeyed even when that caused his death on the cross.
So God raised Christ to the highest place and gave him the name that is greater than any name, so that every person will bow down to honor Jesus Christ, our Lord, and bring glory to God the Father.
Continue to live in a way that gives meaning to your salvation. Do this with fear and respect for God. God is working in you. He helps you to want to do what pleases him, and he gives you the power to do it.
Do everything without grumbling or arguing so that you will be blameless and pure, children of God without any fault.
You live among evil people who have lost their sense of what is right. Don't do anything that they can say is wrong.
As you hold firmly to the message that gives life, shine among them like stars in the dark world.
Last week, we concluded by saying that while we study in order to be the very best representatives of Christ that we can be, the real success of growing a spiritual life in ourselves or in others is not as dependent on our expertise as it is on God's actions in, through, and around us. It is all the better if we can cooperate with his agenda. The fox and the cat almost gets to this point. A cat was walking in the woods and came across the fox. She thought the fox was clever and experienced in all the ways of the world, and so she addressed him pleasantly. "Good morning, dear Mr. Fox. How are you, and how do you get along in these hard times?" The pride-filled fox studied the cat for a long time, trying to decide whether or what kind of answer he wanted to give her. At last, he spoke condescendingly. "Oh, you poor whisker wiper, you silly piebald. You starveling mouse hunter, what makes you think you can dare ask me how I am getting along? What have you learned? How many arts do you master?" "Only one," said the cat meekly. "And what might that one be? When dogs run after me, I can jump into a tree and save myself." "Is that all?" said the fox. "I'm a master of 100 arts, and I have a sack full of cunning tricks. But I pity you. Come with me, and I will teach you how to escape from the dogs." Just then, hunters came along with 4 hounds. The cat sprang and scrambled up into the topmost branch of a tree, and then stealthily crept to where she was entirely hidden by twigs and leaves, and then cried down to the fox, "Open your sack, Mr. Fox, open your sack of tricks." But the dogs had already gripped him and held him fast. And from her high, invisible perch, the cat said to herself as she watched that terrible scene down below, "Oh, Mr. Fox, with your 100 arts and your sack full of tricks, you are held fast, while I, with my one, am safe. Had you been able to creep up here, you too could have been saved. And the moral of the story is that it's not necessarily how much you know, but what you know that counts. It's not how many different things you know, but it is that you know the thing you need to know when you need to know it. And in our context, it is not how much or what, but who we know that really counts. The theme of our series is rising up, and the point of the day is we don't do it by our own bag of tricks, but only by humbling ourselves before God, who then can and will lift us up. So for this week and the next, when this particular series ends next week, our prayer course will remind us that God is most willing to do that. The first time through we sing our prayer course, we will sing it as a statement of faith. God will raise us up. The second time through, as a prayer of faith to God, you will raise us up. Lord, it is good and fitting to praise you. You are kind and trustworthy. You watch over every part of your creation, and you personally know each one. From your abundance, you graciously provide what we need. We thank you for calling in the clouds of water to harvest and supply each need. We thank you for gathering us together and building us up, be it in person or through technology. You bind up our wounds and you heal the heartbroken. You are great and powerful and understand things beyond our imagination. In your time, you bring down the wicked and lift up the humble. Therefore, we did not turn to strength of animals or humans, but to you. For you take joy in us when we honor you and we put our hope in your mercy. We do that by turning to you with open lives, and by lifting our praises and needs to you. This week we named Terry Clark, an old friend of this church who fell and broke her ankle. And for Bill Martin, who's having some eye trouble and has fallen now several times and is having some memory issues. And for his wife, Jan, as she cares for him. And he went to the hospital yesterday and will probably be there for a couple of days at least. We also remember others that have been named previously, or are only known deep within our own hearts in this next moment of silence. Now, Lord, accept the gifts of our prayers, our resources, our time, our talents, our energy to strengthen your people here and throughout the world so that we all may live as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord taught us a prayer, not just to model for us how to speak words to God, but to model our lives as a living prayer to God. It is in that living that we live like Christ and shine like stars in a dark world. That's a mighty task, but Isaiah reminds the intimidated, defeated people of his day that the person who holds the stars holds us, his stars, as well.
Surely you know the truth, don't you? Surely you have heard. Surely someone told you long ago. Surely you understand who made the earth.
It is the Lord who sits above the circle of the earth.
And compared to him, people are like grasshoppers.
He rolled open the skies like a piece of cloth. He stretched out the skies like a tent to sit under.
He takes away the power of the world's leaders. They are like plants that are planted in the ground, but before they are send their roots into the ground, God blows on the plants and the wind blows them away like straw.
The Holy One says, "Can you compare me to anyone? No one is equal to me. Look at the skies. Who created those stars? Who created all those armies in the sky? Who knows every star by name?
He is very strong and powerful, so not one of these stars is lost."
It is because of his powerful strength that may so easily override what would pull us down that we have confidence to lean into our future as we lean into his arms. It says in Deuteronomy 33:27, "The eternal God is your dwelling place, your refuge, your place of safety, and his everlasting arms form a foundation that supports and holds us up forever. Our spiritual journey, our pilgrimage together, will be filled with joy and peace and brightness, for we have nothing to fear with our Lord, so near as we lean on Jesus, our foundation."
What a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. In this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms, and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms.
There's a story of a young soldier who was fighting in Italy during World War II. He jumped into a foxhole as bullets whizzed around him. He immediately began to try and deepen the hole for more protection. As he frantically scraped away at the dirt, he uncovered a crucifix. A moment later, another leaping figure landed beside him as a shell screamed overhead. The first soldier saw on his new companion's collar the insignia indicating that he was a chaplain. He showed the chaplain the crucifix and asked him, "Do you know how to make this thing work?" Isaiah writes to a people who were under fire in Babylon, exiles who didn't seem to know how to make their faith work. In those days, might made right, and the assumption was that the nation who won the war had the more powerful God. So these Jewish captives, victims of the Babylonian Empire's military machine, would have had a hard time not thinking that Babylon's astral deities, their star gods, were the more powerful force. You heard a small portion of Isaiah's majestic Starry Night scenario. Its lesson was much more than a powerful poetic picture of God's majesty displayed in the cosmic nature. It is declaring against common thought that winning or losing on the battlefield doesn't necessarily prove whose deity, whose God is right or better or stronger. The star gods may control the Babylonians, but God creates, controls, counts, and names the stars, and only because of him are they all in place. Our God is not ever a defeated victim of other powers. Even though our circumstances may be difficult, it doesn't mean God is uncaring or powerless. He still loves. He still cares. He still has unlimited power that is not constrained by anything. Hold on to that thought, and we'll come back to it in a moment. In the call to worship, Paul instructed us to shine like stars in a dark world. In the broader biblical context, then, stars give glory to God. Psalm 19 begins, "The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they display knowledge. There is no place where their voice is not heard." In a similar way, people see us, and by the way we shine, they will hear God speaking to them. Stars also give guidance. Before technology, stars were the primary source of finding direction in nighttime travel. Likewise, if people want to find direction in the Christian life, they look for mature Christians to guide them. Stars also dispel darkness. When there are no stars and moon in the sky, when we are away from city and street lights, it can get very dark. But even more than that, when I was a youth, I was in Kentucky and we were on a tour going deep into Mammoth Cave where light does not reach, except for through technology. And they flicked off the light just for a second to demonstrate what real darkness is like. And if they'd left them off for an extended time, we'd all be on the floor. Because in just the second that they flicked them, we lost our balance. Starlight penetrates and removes darkness so that people who have lost their balance, have lost their way in life, can see something to find their way again. Paul describes what glory-giving, guidance-providing, darkness-dispelling, shining stars look like. Stars act worthy of Christ's life. They're not motivated by jealousy, envy, duty, or fear of authority. They are not quarrelsome. They have no anxiety or worry. They have no selfish ambition. They strive for unity. They live in harmony. They are obedient. They have awesome respect for God and for others, and they offer selfless sacrifice. They look out for the interests of others. They help those in need, and they are blameless and pure because they do all of this without complaining or grumbling or arguing. That's a pretty tall order. It's easy to look at a list like this and to realize it is beyond our reach and to settle for doing something different. To stick with Paul's star metaphor, we look to the stars for navigation. We look to God's word for direction, but we don't understand which way they are pointing, or we don't think we can follow that direction, or we may even think the stars must be off because they aren't lining up with the way we want to go. Yet we are clearly instructed to work out our salvation with fear and trembling, meaning eager to honor and make proud our Heavenly Father. For we are accountable to God for maintaining, strengthening, and progressing in our shining Christian faith. So on the one hand, we work hard at growing in our faith. On the other hand, the text is also very clear that we cannot grow in our own strength. It is God who is working within us. It is He who energizes the action of His people and even motivates us to want to grow. And because it is God Himself at work in our efforts, there is no obstacle that can successfully shackle our efforts to shine like stars. This leads us to the remainder of the Isaiah text, picking off up where our reading had left off. Why do you complain the Lord doesn't notice our condition? Why do you say our God doesn't pay any attention to our rightful claims? To frame those questions in Paul's Philippian context, it's kind of like the people would be complaining, doesn't the Lord know or care that faithfulness like that is impossible for us? We'll just wear ourselves out in exasperation if we keep trying. But then the answer comes in Isaiah. Don't you know who made everything? Haven't you heard about Him? The Lord is the God who lives forever. He created everything on earth. He won't become worn out or get tired. No one will ever know how great His understanding is. He gives strength to those who are tired. He gives power to those who are weak. Even young people become worn out and get tired. Even the best of them trip and fall. But those who trust in, who wait on the Lord will receive new strength. They will fly as high as eagles. They will run and not get tired. They will walk and not grow weak. The Lord says, come and stand quietly. Be still in front of me. If you want to shine like stars, you have to remember who created the stars, who sustains the stars, and who calls them out by name. In the New Testament context, where we are the stars, it means He is calling us by name. He puts us where we need to be, and He doesn't let us be forgotten. It is not our own worn-out intentions, our tired attempts or weak efforts that will make that all happen. It is only as we rise up to His calling that we can reach new horizons of growth. It is by waiting on His unending power and His never-flagging energy that keeps us moving forward. Wait, Isaiah says, wait on the Lord. Wait is one of the hardest words to apply in the American language. Some of us get impatient waiting at a red light. And when it is done green, turns green, we are done waiting, we stop waiting, and we just move. It's like they're two opposite things. We wait or we move. But in Bible language, waiting is filled with positive expectation, with complete trust and confidence, and it is accompanied by an ongoing action. Waiting on the Lord is an attitude of trust that we cling to even as we proactively live and move in our daily life. Relying on God to strengthen us, be it in the celebrations of life or in the discipline of more difficult times. This process of waiting and transforming and trusting and strengthening is not idle. It moves forward, and it moves forward in four possible ways. Isaiah says, we fly like eagles. We often picture this as a life of smooth sailing, no problems, a big overarching view that's above all the trenches of life. A life that is great and joyful and easy. But sometimes eagles are soaring because they're starving and they're searching for their next meal. They don't wait in their nest for the Lord to provide. They rely on Him even as they seek that next opportunity to eat. So in easy days or in difficult times, we ambitiously soar into our days and creatively deal with all of our obstacles head on. Somehow lifted, even in challenging circumstances, to envision God's reality breaking into the reality of our world. To see the heavenly kingdom coming and shaping the earth so it is here as it is in heaven. Sometimes we soar like eagles because we recognize that without God we would be nothing, but with Him, our hero, we can fly because, to paraphrase Matt Midler, He is the wind beneath our wing. But sometimes we can't imagine soaring. In those periods, Isaiah promises our waiting can be running without wearing out. strengthened by waiting on the Lord, we'll be able to move quickly. Scripture says, throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us in order to get the prize. With strict training, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, we press on toward the goal for which God has called us heavenward in Christ Jesus. We run without tiring. There are also times when soaring seems a pipe dream and even running seems beyond imagination. And then Isaiah promises that we can walk without getting weak. God said, I will live with them and walk among them, and I will be their God and they will be my people. And since we have these promises, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates. Live in the Spirit, walk in the Spirit, for whoever claims to live in Him must walk as Jesus did, in love and in the light, and as He is in the light. We walk without fainting, getting tired, falling down, failing. But sometimes walking is even beyond us. Pressures mount, roadblocks persist, circumstances relentlessly try to drag us down. We feel like we've been trying to run at full speed in the deep end of a pool. Eventually we're depleted and our muscles begin to cramp. We have to stop and come up for air. Isaiah's word about a light at the end of the tunnel only musters a thought of a train coming the other way to barrel down on us. And though we continue to do our best to make the most of each day, our waiting, our relying, trusting attitude cannot muster the ability to soar or to run or to walk. And we come to a place where we need to be still, stand quietly before God. The psalm says, in your anger, do not sin. Search your hearts and be silent. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations of the earth. And in that silence, our eyes rise upward from ourselves, rise upward from our circumstances, and begin to fix and focus on God. It is in the silence of the ever-speaking night sky that Isaiah reminds the exiles ripped from their homes that that didn't mean they were helpless losers to the star gods of their conquerors, but they still belonged to the God who controlled even these alleged astral deities. It is in the silence that the Spirit can assure us that we are not the helpless victims of circumstances or temptations that seem so much more powerful than ourselves. We are reminded that our life is not ours, and the power we have to live and move and have our being as lights in the darkness is not our power, but His power within us. And He has always been and always will be in control of our lives. We're in the loving hands of the One who never tires and is beyond our ability to comprehend. We are not equal to the task of rising up to realize that God is dawning upon us, rising up to listen, rising up to move, rising up to show and tell, rising up to shine as stars. Rise up with a new focus, then, and throw ourselves back on the One who made the stars and is more than capable of empowering us to rise up, to be and do everything He calls us to be and to do. He renews our strength as we reach out to Him. One way we reach out to Him is to participate virtually this week in the table, communion table, to which He has invited us and through which He is already reaching out to us. Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with Him and with one another. Let's prepare our hearts by singing about being still before God. To your God, to order.
thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still, my soul, your God will undertake to guide the future as in ages past. Your hope, your confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be bright at last. Be still, my soul, the waves and winds still know the Christ who ruled them while he dwelt below.
Let's continue to prepare our hearts through confession. Dear Lord, it dawns on us that we come crashing, tripping, fainting, and collapsing across life's stage. Powerless grasshoppers, tiny ants, puffy seeds blown about by the forces we can't even imagine. Reality rushes in full force, but you come and change our focus, and we realize that the stage of life is not ours, but yours, and you have always been and will always be in control. And our very lives are at your mercy. And so we plead for your mercy because we have sinned against you, against one another, and against the world and the creatures you have called us to tend. We have broken our covenant. We have lost our passion for your mission. We have ignored the needs of others. We have failed to love you and our neighbors in your creation as we have loved ourselves. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Christ our Lord. Amen. The eternal promises of the one who knows you intimately comes to you in overwhelming waves. The everlasting touches the eternity that he has placed in our hearts, renewing strength and restoring hope as Christ reaches himself out to meet us in the stillness of the table, assuring us that if we confess our sin, God is faithful and just and will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. On that basis, in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. May God's peace be with you. The Holy Spirit is with you. You are the Father's. We are all yours, Father, Son, Spirit. All our lives, all our thanks, all our praise, all our hesitations, all our grumbling, all our fears, we give it all to you. With all of our bodies and minds and hearts and spirits and voices. You deserve blessing and praise, for from the beginning of time to the ends of space, you are God, boundless in love and power. What are we that you notice us, much less love us, much less that you should call us into a covenant with you, a relationship with you, that we continually break, yet you continually sustain? How full of mercy you are. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with a song of angels and saints, servants and martyrs, the elders of heaven and the creatures all on the earth and under the earth, with strangers and with family in every generation, saying, Jesus Christ comes in God's name. You are worthy, Lamb of God, for all creation slain. You are worthy. Hosanna to our King. Hosanna to our King. We praise you with our lives and with these gifts of bread and cup, remembering the mystery of faith that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Come upon us, Holy Spirit. Come upon these gifts here and wherever we have them at our homes. Make them be for us Christ's body, Christ's blood. Make us one enlivened body by Christ, one in heart, one in mind, one in you, that we may shine boldly for you, that we may offer your healing for all who are sick, who are torn and weary, that we may be channels of your mercy over all of your works in earth and sky and sea, that the power of death will be vanquished, that all may receive your cleansing grace, that all who are possessed oppressed, distressed, depressed, and downcast may be set free at last. Now come and fill us, Holy Spirit, this day and every day until we eat anew at the marriage supper of the Lamb, of the church, your people, and yourself, and where we will proclaim, "You are holy, God. You are worthy, Christ, worthy in your birth, worthy in your living, worthy in your loving, worthy in your serving, worthy when you preach good news that God's kingdom has drawn near, worthy when you gather disciples then and now to learn and show the world what life under God's reign means. Healing for the sick, new life for the dead, cleansing for the lepers, deliverance for the oppressed, freedom for the possessed, beauty for the lilies, care for the sparrows, new birth, new life, new creation, breaking in for all. You are worthy above all. Worthy too the night we betrayed you, when you took the bread and you blessed it and you broke it, and you gave it to your disciples, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Remember me." Remember what he's done for you as you now take and eat the bread. Worthy too when you took the cup, praise God, and then you shared it, saying, "This is the blood of the new covenant for you. Remember me." Remember as you now take and drink. Now may all blessing and glory, thanksgiving and power, wisdom and honor and might be yours, holy God, now and forever. For he not only asks us to remember what he has done through communion, but through communion he also points us forward to that day when we meet in heaven and we will become like him, for we shall fully see him as he is. God's light has risen upon you, so through you let his light shine in a dark world by rising to live by kingdom values and daring to serve Jesus in new and adventurous ways. Amen.